good kids bad ideas.
Why should he get to skip school when everybody else has to go?
He's giving his eyes to Stevie Wonder.
Phillip Bueller. Ferris Bueller.
Any questions?
Does Barry Manilow know that you raid his wardrobe?
Being bad feels pretty good.
Welcome to Designing Hollywood. I'm your host for today, Phillip Boutte Jr., and I have got a special guest, which is Marilyn Vance, who is the architect and the voice of a generation for so many people, in her clothing, in her work, in her spirit. So let's welcome our guest, Marilyn Vance.
Hi.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. That's a lovely intro. I love that. I hope it was recorded.
Yeah.
No, I'm happy to be here, especially with you. I think that you're such a delight to talk to. And, you know, I know when the things that you're going to want to know will be pertinent to the films and the personality of all of us.
Well, thank you very much for having me, and I appreciate it. And we kind of wanted to give a special just talk to have you sit down and talk about Mr. John Hughes and your collaborations with him, your work with him, because it's so special to many. Those films really are brilliant, and also just the, like I said, the voice of a generation for so many people. So I want to kind of get into them and start talking about them and just your experiences. But I think we first have to get out the boring question, which is, how did you meet John Hughes and how did you come to working with him?
I had just gotten the film, Romancing the Stone.
Mm-hmm.
And I get a call to go meet Joel Silver, this producer, because he wanted me to meet this director from Chicago. I said, okay, great. So we met at Universal, and I met John, and he right then asked me to do 16 Candles. But I was so excited. I was bursting inside of me because I just got Romancing the Stone.
Yes.
I stayed up for days doing boards, even a look in the eye. There was nothing I left out of characters to get that movie. And lo and behold, I got it. So I was really flying.
Mm-hmm.
So then I meet this guy who is very prolific, I understand, has just, you know, came from working on with Bellucci in what's that magazine? I can't think of the name offhand, but he was writing, and he'd write ads for John would just never stop writing. He wrote ads, he did commercials, he did all of those things, copyright. And he was prolific writing these scripts. So when I met him with Joel Silver, he had done this script, 16 Candles, and he asked me to do the film. And I said, I just took a film that I'm really excited about. It's a romance action, you know, and I'm going to be leaving town, and it's going to be a great experience. And okay, so we finished up, and he didn't seem too happy with me. He's a guy, he wore everything on him. His feelings were all over him all the time. Really interesting. And how he put himself out there and how we perceived him, you know? So that was it. I went off. I did Romancing the Stone. I was very excited about that. Come back to town, and they come at me again with another film.
And which one was that?
Which, The Breakfast Club.
Okay, and that was your first John Hughes collaboration.
So,
okay.
Yes, and it was just such an incredible script. I can't even tell you. the way he, especially me, I'm such a visualist. I see everything. I'm talking to you. I could almost see your family, you know, what mm-hmm. they look like and how they dress and how they're perceived. I have, you know, I can't help myself. I do that all the time.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the way it is. I think if I started with more glamorous films, it would be different.
Right.
You know, but I had this like eagle eye for these things. I was able to ascertain exactly the characters, and I surprised myself. But in his writing, it triggered it.
So it feels like his writing is just so prolific in the sense that he seems to almost dream, eat, sleep, breathe character. Like it's like he can see them and they just rush out. And I think that this one, with Breakfast Club, what's so interesting about it is it's primarily just dialogue. Right. So it's just conversations. Most of it, there's like a little running in the halls and stuff like that. But for the most part, it's just dialogue and people. So talk me through like when you first see these characters like arriving.
Right. The arrival is very interesting because visually each one pulls up in what the family car is, or the father or the mother. And each one is in a pickup truck, Emilio Estevez, the wrestler. And each one of them, you realize who they are right then and there, just by their attitude, getting out of the car, the last thing they say to their family. Just so interesting. And then comes Judd Nelson, who comes walking across, like, you know, he's the only one that didn't come, you know, wasn't dropped off by a parent. Mm-hmm. He walked there.
Mm-hmm.
And you just see each one of them, they all, one by one, the cars leave. You see, Molly gets out of a BMW.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. He's walking.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my God. Each character, she goes rolling out of her car. It's so interesting because he comes walking across. Molly is getting out of the BMW.
Mm-hmm.
Michael Hall is getting out of the station wagon with mm-hmm. his little sister and the mother. So, and she's already telling him, you know, this and that and behave. You better get your work done today.
Right.
This is the brainiac of the group anyway. And so each one, their personality was just right there, you know. You see what their family is. It's just a glimpse and it works. And then you see him come trotting across in this coat and boots and a scarf. And he was just, you know, a wise guy.
How did you come to, you know, specifically, like, since we're looking at this one, how did you come to that look? Because you had, I know you did your boards, and then you were also picking different colors and stuff like that. So walk me through, like, what that kind of meant to you or how you were trying to separate them out.
It had to speak for itself,
yeah.
However they were represented themselves. So he had ripped shirt, you know, the flannel shirt. I gave him red because he was red, mm-hmm. his personality, you mm-hmm. know. And each one was color-coded. Emilio was blue.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Michael Hall was green and khaki. Tan, sort of, you know, they each had, and Molly, of course, pink and brown. But
I want to segue a little bit just in terms of talking about that, because I want to ask you this question, which is, what was it like? Because there's so many stars in this film that, like, you know, fresh faced people that yeah. ended up becoming huge stars. What was it like working? Did you know that it was going to become that? Or did you know that it was going to spawn off these great careers of all these people that were literally like, you know, they were that generation in that time period. Did you look at it that way, or were you just more in it and didn't?
No, I really, they were going to be leaders of a type of
yeah.
kid. And they're people, other children, other kids, I don't know how to, kids, teenagers, will relate to one of those guys.
Each one.
Yeah. And except with Allie, I had to use black, and there was no black at the time working. So that her father's black cashmere sweater,
mm-hmm.
and then the scarf, we made her skirt and her purse because
you made her purse.
Yes, it was all fabric, you know, one of those kind of, yeah, just everything. So it had to be dark because that's who she was, and she was hiding, mm-hmm. and in herself in black. That was it. So each one had, you know, like Emilio, in order to make him also look great, mm-hmm. I had to not use a waist jacket. His Letterman jacket fell longer.
Right.
I work very closely with their bodies because they had one outfit and they had to disrobe and lose the outer layers.
You were talking about this a little bit, which is you were saying they had to lose layers to, what, wasn't it really cold?
It was freezing, inside, right. Inside the library of the school where they were sitting, they each, you know, they shed their outerwear, and each one had this outfit that you're looking at right now. Except Emilio, he eventually takes that off, and he's got a tank top.
Nice.
'Cause he's a wrestler. And he, he had a really rough relationship with his father. Each one pulling up, you could see that the mother is bickering with Michael Hall, you know, in the car. And yes, okay, and you better do this. And, you know, it was that kind of kid is always like, getting the finger in his face.
And all of that dialogue was on the page. So basically you're pulling out and looking at each one of these, almost like as each kid arrives, it's like a snapshot of who they are, and you need to establish that right away so that from very beginning you already know who these people are.
Right.
Right?
From the way they get out of the car, and Ali Sheedy, she rolls out of the car and she's not even out and her father pulls away. It's just, it's real, and she's standing there looking. You know, she was a sad case, and each one had that emotional aspect coming out. Judd Nelson, he was angry. He didn't like his life at all. Molly was a brat, spoiled. And they would never be friends in school. So here they are, stuck 8 hours together.
Mm-hmm.
And things started coming out. You know, he shot 24 hours of film. Do you realize they had an incredible editor. And it took her forever because he just kept wanting to get to the core of things. So it was like a shrink. He would keep, okay, let me hear that again, you know. And
so he's needing to really make sure that these characters are coming through.
Oh, God, yeah. He really did, and he caught them to begin with. He wrote the piece the way they look, in my head anyway.
Mm-hmm.
That's who they were. And, you know, John, spectacular when it came to addressing who's what and how they are perceived and the dialogue. And he wants to get the emotion out of each one. Like Molly, she's spoiled, hates her family, has diamond earrings, you know. Just Emilio is pressured to be the wrestler and be a winner.
Right.
You know, and each one has their hang up from whatever they come from their family. You know.
So you're thinking through the characters in terms of who they are first, and showing a snapshot of that. You're also thinking about layering them up so that they can layer down because they are spending this time in detention and they're just all together for 8 hours. So then they're having different layers. And when they're pulling back their layers, you're also thinking about what that reveals to them as a person, as a character.
Emotionally. Yeah.
I think also too, in researching these characters, how did you research them knowing that, you know, you're going from like, you know, L.A., obviously different kids, so different type of kid in L.A. versus Chicago. So what was your thought process in trying to research the type of kids that you would be dressing for this film?
I went and looked at schools and went, you know, like I did with Fast Times in L.A.
Mm-hmm.
I would always research what I was about to do and what these kids look like, because Chicago is freezing. Or in one day, you could have three seasons in Chicago off the lakes.
Mm-hmm.
It changes radically. But anyway, it was winter.
Yes.
And it was cold. And the layers were incredibly, worked so well because of where they were and had to be in this one area, wind up together and strip down all the layers till the nitty gritty, till you got to who they were.
Do you feel like, because you just mentioned it, do you feel like when you were doing Fast Times, do you feel like Fast Times just getting in the head of like kids, like do you feel like that prepared you later on for then working with Hughes?
It's so different.
It's different. It's completely different.
It's so different.
Yeah.
You're dealing with, they didn't get into the psychological aspect of anything. It was just, you know, Sean was the character.
Right.
That was it. Hey, man, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, that was it. They were all who they were. Nothing was hidden. Nothing. Everything was out there in Fast Times. It was simple. It was really simple. This is very intense, very, very layered. The personalities, the writing. Thank God he was such an extraordinary writer that they were able to shed those layers in front of each other and the audience. And that's what made the film so incredible. Young people that would watch it could relate to at least one of
those characters. One of them. You could find yourself in it.
Yeah.
So then the other question I have, like, if we transition, let's talk about, if we're talking about, like, Pretty in Pink, right? So we're going from Breakfast Club to Pretty in Pink. You have Molly again. But before, Molly's this spoiled, hates her parents, very prissy, very, you know, like, her clothing, you know, she's got, you know, she's...
Diamond earrings.
Yeah, diamond earrings. She's able to afford, you know, it's like Ralph Lauren, all these different things, right? Now, she's dirt poor. So how did, like, talk us through just the juxtaposition of that and then working on that film.
That was really interesting because Molly and our ducky come from the other side of the railroad tracks, supposedly.
Mm-hmm.
That's me making that dress sort of too. They are the quintessential hip poor kids. Really. That had a way to show themselves, they express themselves through what they look like, what they wore, you know, and that was important to them. That was her thing and his thing, too, which I think we don't know that, you know, they shop together or anything like that. It's just that they're so unique and individual unto themselves, both of these characters, because they were undernourished as far as clothing, you know, they created looks and things that made them feel unique and who they were. They tried, anyway, to be... They never tried to be a Richie, you know, as they called them, Richies. Yeah, they never tried to be those people. They were not accepted in that crew at all. Not at all. And when Molly... You know, it's so funny because her father in the film is so extraordinary, and he's crying. What a great actor.
Mm-hmm.
And Molly is also so great. It just rips your heart out when you realize what a struggle young kids that don't have things go through.
Yes.
And how they are perceived and how they want to be perceived and how that's why they dress in their unique way, because it satisfies something within them. And
it's almost like armor, too, right? Like it's either they're hiding or they're coming to school armored up with what they're wearing to protect themselves from what they experience at home. It's either very telling what they're wearing, meaning it shows exactly who they are and where they're coming from, or it's like their chance to be something else. Which
it's kind of both.
It's kind of both, right?
Yeah, it really is. Yeah, because they push themselves to go wherever, even though they don't fit in the way, visually maybe, but they do things that are so unique and they look so great. And her character was just fantastic. When she's sketching, she's wearing that cutaway turtleneck black, and she's sketching her dress, and she's in bed. And she's thoughtfully touching that, and that winds up to be the style of the top of the dress, you know, which I know, but I don't know who else picked up on it. But, you know, I have to work with things like that. It kind of makes sense to me, especially in a film like this where they have to put their own looks together. Mm-hmm. And her first look was incredible in the movie. She's wearing her glasses and a hat, and there's just a thing around the head, and she's wearing a sweater. And I went and I got charms in this button store. All little charms, a little iron, a mm-hmm. little this, a little, you know, golf clubs, whatever, dolls. And I sewed them on that pink sweater on top of the jewelry.
Now, what brought you to that? Because that's really cool.
Unique. Her character is different. Was she not only wearing wonderful sweater that came from the thrift store, but she embellished, and then she had her earrings, and totally. And the lace vest that she wears over this little lace thing mm-hmm. that she makes, you know, you could see she makes her clothing.
You make her clothing that she makes.
Right. And she rearranges. Exactly. And how she rearranges clothing.
Okay.
To work for her, too.
Now, we have been showing this picture. Do you want to talk about this iconic dress that you made, basically?
Okay. There are two dresses. You see the one being picked up, but you can't really tell what it is. This mm-hmm. one's in the background. You see that mm-hmm. fluffy pink? So, to do her dress in the film, she goes to she goes to her friend's house. She's wearing my jacket, by the way. I never got that back, the Korean. Come to think of it, she goes to Annie Potts' house, and she needs a dress. She knows she needs a dress now. So Annie Potts brings out her beautiful prom dress, mm-hmm. puts it on with her big fluffy slippers and her beehive hairdo, and they're dancing. But she went there with purpose to get that dress.
Okay.
Yeah. So she gets that dress, and all is well. And then she goes home, and her father comes back, and they have no money, mind you, mm-hmm. and with a bag. And he goes, here. And in the bag is a dress, also pink.
Right.
And you could see that two dresses. So the two dresses become one. You watch her on her bed sketching what she's going to do. Like I said, she touches the turtleneck piece, the cutaway top, as she's sketching. Mm-hmm. And the next thing you know, she's got that style.
That style,
in
right.
In her prom dress. So, you know, you have to, what I do, because things like this, you have to be so real.
Right.
And at the same time, you could look so stupid. You could make the actor really, really, really not look good, especially when they trust in you, which they should have, because you're going to show them before anything. I showed them the character boards. It was very important that they saw what I saw, mm-hmm. the character, who they were. And that's the difference of, you know, doing something. It's intimate. And, you know, people don't realize that. And also, I had to be careful because clothing dates itself. It really put a label on the date all the time. And I really didn't want the film to be, oh, look at that. You know when they used to wear that?
Right.
And you know it. So I was very, very in tune with the fact that that's not going to happen on this film. That's so just to keep it not going to happen.
Kind of classic, so that it wouldn't date itself immediately, like something huge or.
Oh yeah, because at the time it was Thierry Mugler with big shoulders, mm-hmm. and oh my God, you know, I love the Japanese, but I use that for other things, mm-hmm. but not this film. But the simplicity, even in times when things were like raging, it was very simple.
And you were talking about, like, I guess in terms of, like, even when you're bringing that up, you're thinking about, like, in your own work, kind of trying to infuse some of the fashion, some of the things that are going on then, but then also trying to push them forward or pull them back, right? Like, so sometimes it's, like, about taking this thing and saying, okay, this is with the trend, and it's something that this character would do, or it's saying, I want this to be timeless, and so I have to pull that back away from what's going on now so that it'll have legs, right?
Totally.
Yeah.
And the hardest one to pull together because of that was Ally Sheedy, because black was not happening. I had to make her skirts and her purse. And, mm-hmm. you know, we needed to get that darkness, not everything solid black, of course, but because the transition that she's going to make, but even before then, she comes, her hood is over her head, mm-hmm. you know, the fur, you can't see her face. She's totally a mess. Hiding a psychological mm-hmm. wreck.
Mm-hmm.
And so we showed that. We showed that in what she looked like and how she dressed and her layers and black as well, black and gray, dull. Because she would love to have been invisible. She would have loved that. And each one had that a sensibility about themselves. You know, our wrestler, Emilio, he was being pushed all the time to do better and do better. And, you know, he was kind of a small guy. So I took his T-shirt and I cut it in so he looked more.
So to give him broader shoulders.
Yeah. You do little tricks like that to enhance and help.
I say there's two tricks that you just have mentioned now, which is basically you, for Emilio, because he's shorter, you gave him a broader shoulder by cutting in his shirt more, and then you also gave him a longer jacket.
Yes.
To make him look.
Not so it sat on his waist.
Right.
Just, you know, you didn't know where the waist was. It was just.
Those are little secrets that I'm always interested in, too, because I think I didn't notice those until I started working in costume and how much the costume designer really pays attention to the body and then how they're trying to kind of become an architect and carve and push and pull and move and trying to make people look their best. Or sometimes make them look not their best, depending on the character, right?
But you're incredible to know that, you know. I mean, a lot of people don't realize that. I mean, I don't want to date this movie. Everything I do, I try not to date it, unless mm-hmm. it's like The Untouchables, and it's 1931, and that's it, and fine. But when you're doing these young films, fashion is so poisonous because it inflicts a look. It's not your own.
Right.
It's what, you know, what label is that? Let me see. I love that company. Oh, it's great.
So it feels like the fashion inflicts a look of the company or whatever, as opposed to it being, fashion sometimes takes away the why. So it takes, and for a John Hughes film, the why is the most important part, which is why does this person wear what they wear? Why are they, or who are they?
Right.
And you're always trying to find the core root of that. So it's like, would she wear this? Why? What's the purpose? Where's it? And then also, how is it helping to back up the story points?
Right.
Like, how does it help back up the family that she comes from or whatever? So I think that you were able to really find the core root of these things, which ultimately speaks to the collaboration that you guys had, because his writing is very, it's all cerebral and all character-based. So let's move to, I want to talk about Ferris Bueller. Tell me some fun stuff about working on Ferris Bueller.
Ferris Bueller was so trippy, honestly. It was a great experience. Once again, I'm dealing with the problem of the period and trying not to, you know, beyond the nose for what was happening at that time. So taking his personality, Ferris Bueller's personality, he wasn't a jock. He wasn't a letterman.
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't a hitter, you know, a tough guy. So I took three elements and made that jacket, the gray, black, and white, off of the fact of little pieces of what those other jackets would be into his own style.
So that's a good point. So never thought about that before because you just look at it. So you were combining three different elements of different jackets to kind of make him, to fit his character of being not really any of those things.
Right.
That's really cool. So then in the thought process, was that like a deliberate choice in terms of you saying like, okay, he's not this, he's not that.
Oh, yeah.
So you're kind of trying to find a meld of the perfect mix of him being a little bit of all of these different things.
Right.
That's very
exactly.
cool. That's so
and
cool.
Also, that vest was not a vest. It was a sweater.
Mm-hmm.
I looked all over everywhere to something different and wound up in Marshall Fields buying a men's sweater. It had sleeves. I cut the sleeves off, mm-hmm. and that became his sweater vest. And the pants he's wearing are actually a Perry Ellis suit that he puts on the suit.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a bluish gray and black houndstooth. You can't hardly see what mm-hmm. it is at the pattern. So that is the suit when he picks her up and he puts the raincoat over. You know, everything had the connection. Nothing is a surprise, really. It's like, oh, where'd that come from? You know, you kind of realize what's going on. I like to do that because I feel that it helps the character and it helps you to get to know who the character is and how they're putting themselves together.
Now, let's do a quick exercise because this is a really iconic shot and it's fun. And you have three characters here, each of which. So we've talked about Ferris's look. Walk me through the other two.
Okay. Well, see, she's wearing shorts.
Yes.
They're suede.
Okay.
Yes. And I copied British Gurkhas. You know, those khaki British Gurkha mm-hmm. shorts, the men's shorts? Yeah. I copied them for suede for her
okay.
to give her an originality, like not a skirt, not a, you know, no jeans, nothing like that. So I made her that, got that belt also, and I got the Burkers at a shop, Fred Siegel.
Okay, Fred Siegel.
And I copied them.
Okay.
I had that pulled them apart, a leather person who also made the jacket for me.
What's the idea with her fringe? Yeah.
The idea with that was the fact that if I gave her just a little bolero, it looked so dressy. It didn't look, you know, kind of. So I added the fringe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the same with her jewelry and the same with her undershirt underneath over another piece because she gets undressed to go swimming.
See, which also then layers again.
Yes.
So you're breaking down
exactly.
your characters. Okay.
And she's got boots, gray boots. They were the most expensive thing in the whole picture. Yeah. High, soft boots. So she it shows that she comes from money,
mm-hmm.
sort of,
mm-hmm.
you know. And his thing shows his quirky personality.
Right.
Yeah. And then we have him, Gordie Howe, the famous hockey star.
Mm-hmm.
That's his jersey.
That's his jersey. Okay.
We had to get him, and he gave it to us.
Wow.
For him. Yeah. Yeah. But under that is like an army T-shirt,
mm-hmm.
army green, with that medical thing. But I had to put it inside out because you could see what it was, but not on the nose because I didn't want to get sued. I didn't know whose it was.
Right.
Yeah. So, and he's got skinny leather suspenders, this one. Yeah.
And so now we've got these three characters.
And the hats. They each had hats. No, she didn't. Really.
She didn't have a hat.
No.
Okay, so then you have these three characters and you kind of fleshed them out all differently. And now with this particular process, did you do the same thing? Did you do like some boards and kind of start to pick through and do some research? And
absolutely.
And after this point, now since you've already done, you did Breakfast Club, you did Pretty in Pink, did you have like in your mind a thought process is like better as to like who these kids are? Or did you feel like you really had to kind of dive in again? Like each one, do you feel like you're diving in or did you feel like you were picking up and carrying knowledge you had from before?
You know how it worked? It was really funny. We should ask that because it wasn't quite like that.
Yeah.
Dressing them, their final outfits, and then goodbye.
and then they're out.
Go. Okay. You're done.
Got it.
Yeah. Because if you labor too much over all these things, you wind up changing stuff. You mm-hmm. wind up not being pleased. Oh, I love that. But I don't know about that now, you know. But you can't do that when you're having one outfit, basically. I always get those kind of shows.
It's like a one outfit. Like, this must last this character this entire thing.
How far can you go upside down, inside out? You know, what more can you do? So, and I gave her very delicate, beautiful, all real jewelry. And the watches.
Did the actors bring anything to their character? Like, in terms of just, like, did they say anything? Or is it just like, you were just like, this is what it is. I love that. So,
well, you're talking about John Hughes.
Yeah.
It's on the page.
It's already on the page, right?
Not the attitudes on the page.
Right.
You know, not exactly how they dress, but I take that and I decipher his attitude. And I put the boards together, do the look, show them where I'm going. I never would do things without them understanding how I see her character
mm-hmm.
or how I see Ferris, you know, in different patterns and things like that, why I would do that. So I have to already suss that out before the show even actually starts. I have to know where each thing is going.
Well, so much of these, the movies too, or the work, they're like, it's like, I like to think of them almost like they're like snapshots of life, like Detention
yeah.
or, you know, like a day off. Like, it's kind of like focusing on this one point. So it's like you really do have to be specific and like, I need to nail what this person is straight out the gate because this is pretty much the way you see them.
And it's like, not easy.
Yeah.
It's not, because that's really what you just said is exactly, you know. You have to be that close to what their likes are and dislikes and how they live and where they come from in order to get to this. And once you're here, that's it.
Now I'm going to ask a very costume-centric question, at least in terms of like costume people,
sure.
which is obviously these are like you're doing some custom pieces, you're finding stuff, you're moving things around. Did you have any mishaps or did you have multiples? Did you have anything where like something broke or messed up and like you couldn't replace it or you were trying to figure out or you had to fix it?
No, thank God.
Okay.
No. On one film I did, something like that happened. It was a horror trip. Not, thank God, none of these. Yeah, none of these didn't work that way. But boy, when that happens, yeah.
Well, especially when you're doing something custom, like you find a sweater, you cut off the sleeves, and does that sweater rip? And then it's like, okay, what do you do?
Yeah.
Like, okay.
I had to have multiples.
Okay, you did have
you
multiples.
Know. Yeah, of
yeah,
course.
That's what yeah. I was just like making sure.
And he had two jackets, the 2 3-tone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. One was for the stunt guy.
What's
they
the
just
story
sold
behind
it for $30,000.
Jeez.
I know. With a hole in the back. So when he was running, mm-hmm. if he fell, they would pull him back on the rope.
Ah, so there was a hole
so
in it for
the
yeah.
the stunt guys, yeah.
Question for you then too, what's the story behind these pants?
The story behind those pants is they were just something. Look at nothing matches.
Yes,
it's
right.
Where his head is at. Look at his sneakers, mm-hmm. you know. This is who Ferris is. He's a character. Look what's on the chair.
One of the things that's really cool to me about the way that you did Ferris specifically, one of the things that I thought specifically that I find interesting about Ferris is that in costume designing him, when you're talking about all of the different layers that he had and then how you were combining the jacket, it feels as almost like he's malleable, meaning that he hasn't. Some of the characters are very specific, like this is a jock, this is a, you know, a nerd, this is a this. But Ferris is so quirky, it feels like you costume designed him in a way to where he's a little bit of everything, meaning that he hasn't figured out. He knows who he is, but he hasn't figured out quite who he is yet. So maybe in the future when we see him as an adult, he's like, okay, now I'm this.
Right.
But right now he's in this like malleable stage, kind of like a child, where
that's
it's like,
yeah.
I think that that's kind of cool. And his clothing feels yeah. like it's. It's like, wait, what? None of that matches. What's going? What are you doing? You know, it's
yeah.
like he hasn't picked.
Yeah. No, that's a good. I like that. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that that's kind of an interesting snapshot for him. And I think now we got to move into one of my favorites, too.
And also that horrible bathrobe he wears.
Yes, well, I mean, but that's all stuff that's just kind of like a part of the character.
Yes.
It's quirky.
Yes, totally.
And I want to move into my favorite, which is Weird Science.
Okay.
So you have to tell me, like, what was, like, how did that come about, first off? Like, in terms of, like, being approached to do Weird Science and, like, kind of getting your head into these, you know, obviously this, like, kind of teenage boy fantasy, you know, that thing. Like, how did you wrap your mind around starting that?
Well, once again, with John Hughes, you know, and his writing and the scripts. And I'm a sucker for, you know, this kind of trying to show and not date things, mm-hmm. not allow them to get old and, you know, and just keep it in character as best you can, no matter what year you're in.
Yeah.
You should be able to, you know. Anyway, so we had a different woman in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
She was like Rod Stewart's girlfriend, a model. And she just wasn't effective talking and trying to nurture the two boys.
Mm-hmm.
So they had to let her go.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they had to. It was not going to happen. Lisa's a very important piece of this.
Right.
And next comes flying in Kelly LeBrock,
mm-hmm.
who was just perfect. Perfect. And also a model, but didn't have that same, she didn't pose. She, you know, the other girl was beautiful,
mm-hmm.
but.
Yeah, so posing. So,
strike a pose.
Right.
You know, constantly. She wasn't an actress.
And this character very much so needed
she,
to kind of find that element, that human element.
She's a character.
Yeah, character,
it
for sure.
It was great. It was great. She comes flying in, and it was, couldn't be better. She was really game for everything, and that's what really worked. And she was spent time with the boys for real.
Mm-hmm.
This was a great trip. This was very interesting, and she made it even more so.
Now, did you spend time like with each of the characters, like just personally, did you spend time to get to know them, or did you kind of have a thought process in mind already? Because I know you started with your boards again and then trying to kind of figure out their looks. But then did you have any specific influences like that kind of influenced you for the time? Like, I know, like, or like for, like, say, this look. Like, was there something that you were thinking about? Like, because it's like it's a kind of a period type, you know, it looks like it's of the time.
Yes.
With the high, you know, the high bikini line and all of those things.
Right.
Was there a thought process that you had with that kind of trying to create those shapes?
I had to come up with something that was sexy, mm-hmm. but not totally revealing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it says Sherma, the high school.
Right.
You know? And it gave her that cutaway, which was, you know, enough.
Yeah.
And no cleavage, nothing like that. Just kind of played it for straight. And that's how she played it, not sexy at all. Yeah. Just kind of present. And she was great. She was absolutely perfect for the part. And dressing her was great and doing all those crazy outfits with her. That was fun. You didn't even get to see some of them, unfortunately.
Do you have fitting photos or pictures of them still?
They're at the Academy.
Oh, they're at the Academy. Yeah. Well, but they exist.
They exist.
Okay.
Oh, with me, you know, the visuals, everything exists because I live off of that. For me, I really dig into the character.
Mm-hmm.
I'll go back in time. I'll go even forward. I'll do whatever I have to do to kind of feel right for their acting. And I've always been like the actor's person, always. That was very important to me, to be able to do that, not just, you know, put on a dance outfit and get out there.
Well, it also feels like you were thinking about things specifically. Like, I know, like, in this film, you're kind of thinking about, like, you're thinking about things that look good on her, things that kind of accentuate her, and then you have these two teenage boys to play off of, and then you also have to think about in the mindset of the character of the teenage boys, what would they find sexy or attractive as well? So there's like that really fun play on like the fantasy part of that. I also know that like when you first see her and she's kind of in that doorway and there's like the backlighting and the smoke and the and all of that, I think she's in like a cutoff, like a sweater or something. Can you walk me through that?
And just a little like, jockey.
And a little, yeah. So it's like, what was that about? Like, because they're basically kind of trying to dress and kind of, and she comes to life. So like, what was that
thought? Couldn't be naked.
Right.
So she had to be in something that was relatable to underwear.
Yes.
And that's what we did.
Okay, so that's what you were kind of thinking about.
It was, yeah, it was something, I would have loved her to come out. But she comes out and, you know, listen, they have bras on their head.
Mm-hmm. Right, right.
Know, they're crazy. They're adorable. It's just wild. Dressing them was great, too, because I mismatched things and gave them suits that was kind of really cool patterns. And Anthony Michael Hall, when he goes out and he's talking like this, he's a real character. I loved it. They were just fantastic. Working with these guys was great.
And how did you, because you collaborated with Anthony Michael Hall several times. Like, how was that collaboration kind of like, how did it grow and foster between the two of you?
It didn't.
Yeah.
It didn't, really. It wasn't like that. It
was
kind of like, you do your, you have your things laid out.
Mm-hmm.
It's what I believe was the right way to go with this character.
Right.
So always, this, dressing rooms were ready to be, you know, used and to try on and to do everything. So they were used to me.
Yes.
I would get excited. I can't wait to put this on, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And they were like, they were into it. It was cool. They trusted me because John did.
Right.
I mean, they did because of John, honestly. I don't know if I could have gotten away with what I did, how I did it without, you know, getting all these approvals from the actors themselves, their character was formulated. Come on, let's go. So it was like doing a period film, actually, working with John Hughes.
Okay.
Because you're creating different aspects of the same thing. It's like you're working and you're building characters, and what would they wear, and how would they act, and how could they move in this, or, you know, what color is that going to be? It's going to clash with this one. It's so incredibly, it's grueling, really, to hope, because then you have your fingers crossed, that because you get away with so much, and then finally they're wearing whatever it is you decided, and you're nervous because they really haven't looked at themselves like that now that I dress that character.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of times, I mean, not often, I had a couple of little, you know, things go, especially Molly with her prom dress and her, it was, she wound up having to wear it anyway, but it just, you know, especially the younger films, you know, there's so much entailed and they're so involved in how they look. And I had to say, you know, I don't want to be, one of them wanted an outfit that was so on the nose of the time.
Right.
And I said, you can't, I would love that. Go get it for yourself.
For yourself, but not for this character.
Yeah.
Right.
So I mismatched things for them when they got dressed up, and they had, it was great. I had a ball on this one. I made her so many incredible things.
Now, talk me through now moving into Some Kind of Wonderful.
Oh.
So talk me through just the process of like approaching that one or starting it.
Some Kind of Wonderful. The process with that, once again, starts with John Hughes' story and Eric Stoltz, who I love. They actually, I was on The Untouchables when I finished this.
Okay.
And I get a call from the director. You got to come here to the school. Eric is not going to wear what you have laid out. I'm in Chicago.
Right, so you're not even there, right.
Yes. You got to come. And they're both Paramount films. I said, okay, because I loved Eric, and he really clashed with the director. They were enemies. I never, you know, never involved with since or ever hoped to be two characters that feel that way about each other. Really bad.
Really difficult.
It was very difficult. I had to fly in quietly. I could have gotten fired. Howie gets on the phone. You got to come, and you got to talk to Eric. Mm-hmm. You got to be here. You got to work with him. And he didn't even have a vast wardrobe or anything. He just didn't like Howie Deutsch. He didn't care for him.
Yeah.
And he wasn't going to, you know, he just didn't want to listen to anything he had to say.
Okay.
As far as he was concerned.
So that's one thing that I will say, too, is that most costume designers will tell you they end up being psychiatrists because you have to then weed through all of that.
All of that.
Okay, so tell me how you approach this.
I quietly got a plane ticket. I took the red eye. They picked me up. Fortunately, both Paramount Pictures. So mm-hmm. they picked me up at the airport and took me straight to, where was it? Not in L.A., San Pedro.
San Pedro,
yeah.
Okay.
They took me to the school there. And there was his trailer locked. And, hi.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, I'm here. Who's there? I said, Marilyn. He said, what? I said, yeah. What's going on here? You know, and
mm-hmm.
nice talk. I loved him. And it's just, they were oil and water. It was just personality
to clash. Okay.
And he loves to be sullen anyway,
right?
So this really gave him reason to be that guy.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't very flattering. I told him to. I said, you gotta get through this. This is a very important piece for you, because you're starring in something, and it's many sides of a person, an artist, a young man who falls in love, how he deals with his family, who have no money, and he wants to go to college. And it's such an important role that this young adult, you know, is, it's really important. Plus, Leah, she and Howie got married after that. They're married now.
Yeah.
They're still married. Yeah, she was great. And my drummer girl, now, you don't even appreciate what she's wearing or how she is, because she was absolutely my favorite to dress. I made her, she was drummer.
Mm-hmm.
So I made these red leather gloves with fringes. Mm-hmm. And you see her do it in
with the
hand. Unfortunately, I don't have pictures. There's not really one picture of her with that. And that was so special because I couldn't find anyone to make gloves, and I couldn't find gloves that I could then. So we finally found someone and made those gloves with the fringes.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just John.
So you're just thinking about something very
loved
custom.
It.
Right.
Loved it. But Howie directed this one as well.
Mm-hmm.
And he and Leah are married.
Right.
They met on that. Yeah. Yeah.
So
the drummer girl, she was wonderful. So I dressed her in cut-off jeans.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she had sort of a heavy combat-style shoe. And at the end, she's the chauffeur. So I got her that long jacket, and she's wearing my cap again, another version of that. And after that, they finished the film, and I just loved, I love doing that. I just love putting these guys together, but this was an unhappy set, you know?
So it was difficult. It was a more difficult one.
Very difficult. When the emotion, you know, when he is acting like that toward a director, it's not right. It's just not right. You know, control yourself. Don't come out of your trailer. Make me fly in from Chicago.
Well, how do you, like, in terms of then moving that back, when you kind of circled it back and you got it back on track, like, in terms of getting their looks correct,
mm-hmm.
how did you pull it together? Like, because it seems like there was a lot of strings being pulled. So how did you just decide to, like, okay, this is how we're going to hone in and focus?
Well, Leah Thompson comes from the popular group of girls.
Mm-hmm.
So she's more together in how she's dressed. She's got shorts and a jacket, matching suit, you know, in like a reddish color. And she's more involved with the girls that are the ones who dress great and drive in the Jeep. And, you know, although she's not one of them, she wants to be one of them. So in the script, she's with them. And they're the outcasts. He's an artist, and she is his best friend. And they both come from not a lot.
Mm-hmm.
She especially, she was a latchkey kid. She wears her house key around her neck. Yeah, yeah. Her mother worked all the time. She just didn't have.
Anybody listening now, that's also a sign of the times. If you don't know what the latchkey kids were, I remember I'm a kid of the 80s, and there was always talk of latchkey kids where kids would come home and their parents weren't home until super late. I think that's also something that's kind of lost on this generation now. If you're listening and you kind of don't understand that, like, I remember still even myself walking home from school, and there was at least be a good hour or two before my parents were home. So it was like, you're home, you've got your key,
yeah.
You come in, I'd make myself something to eat, which I can't even imagine. My daughter's about to be 10. I can't imagine her doing any of this. Like, she would just
you
be like,
you haven't let her?
No, definitely not. It's also just a different time, even just walking home by yourself. You know, from like first grade on,
yeah.
I would walk to the bus stop, catch the bus, go to school, come back, and then I'd be at home for like an hour or two. Before my parents.
It.
Yeah, but I just remember, you know, and then my parents would come home. We'd say hi. They'd make dinner. I was doing my homework. So it's a different time. So anyways, I sequited to say, like, I remember that time a lot. But go ahead.
No,
tell me
I'm
about this.
Saying,
yeah.
Yeah.
So you put her in shorts again.
Yeah, with the denim shirt and our drummer girl. Oh, I just loved her. And their look was simple. And the rest of the kids, I dress most of the kids. What I do is when they have a high school,
mm-hmm.
you like with Pretty in Pink, I ran to Kmart and I bought all sorts of crummy beige tops and shorts and light blue and anything I could find, and we dressed the extras.
Got it.
So you didn't notice. Oh, look, that one's over there. No.
Okay, wait. So you were kind of color palette coding
always.
The extras so that they always just kind of blended in.
That's right.
And that your main characters were always the forefront.
That's right.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
So you were thinking about the whole thing, too, as an overall collective, like a painting, basically,
yeah.
Saying, okay, I need the characters to pop out.
That's why John and I got along.
Yeah.
Because I understood behind the word, you know. Where we're going with this and how we're going to do this. And so I was able...
There's the glass.
Yeah, I was able to creep into her, into his mind.
Yeah.
And we got along really great with that. You know, Howie was very instrumental in the fact that he was the very, very understanding director and treated them with great respect and care. And that's why he wanted me to come in, because he wasn't having a good thing with Eric.
So it was
and
just
I had
kind of
a relationship
like coming in and, yeah,
with Eric.
And balancing it out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But on the whole, everyone, another high school movie,
mm-hmm.
could I say?
Well, these movies, even though they really are kind of the voice of a generation, like it's a whole snapshot of like culture and clothing and lifestyle and like all these little themes that were happening during the time. And I think as you moved along.
See the colors?
Yeah, see there, the color palettes. It's just very kind of like they're blending out. I think that that's kind of an interesting way of looking at it. So you kind of approach that. You get your main characters, get them, and then with your background, you're kind of saying, like, I'll give little snapshots, an impression of a background of kids without
yeah.
getting too specific.
Yeah.
I think
where
that's
they
really
can't,
cool.
No one's so outstanding that you go, look at that, look at that. You know,
yeah.
You're looking at the whole.
Well, especially when you have movies where it's primarily character-driven and they're talking about a lot of things and you're supposed to be focused on what they're saying, right? It's focused on the dialogue, focused on the character.
It's very hard. It's very hard. If you have an actor gives you a problem about the direction you're going in, you know, and you have to psychologically explain what their role is,
mm-hmm.
because this is what I was hired to do, you know. I'm hired to do that guy, not this one.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it worked out well, because psychologically you talk and you make them feel good and you give them, like, they're choosing it on their own. Put enough stuff that you like together. So no matter what they choose, you like it.
Right.
It'll work.
Now,
and then you have to think of doubles and triples, of course, but that comes later.
There's something that we have to talk about, because I know, especially for John Hughes fans, we have to talk about music.
So
the music of these films, because that's like a key component of all of it.
Yes.
It's kind of like in the background, but it's also a big point. Like, so there's, he's famous for saying, or John was famous for saying, I let the movies sell records. That's one thing. And also, he was somewhat of a self-professed music snob,
mm-hmm.
where he basically said he would look internationally to international charts and he would import music to himself so that his friends didn't have the same stuff. He was definitely opposed to the top 40 charts.
Totally.
So let's talk about music and how that influenced these films and then inherently influenced you.
Well, I come out of that area.
Yes.
You know, in New York, I come out of the rock and roll thing, basically. And so I understood how the music affects everybody.
Mm-hmm.
But when I started working for John Hughes, I mean, I did Romancing the Stone, and everything was, it was never like this. This was so intense, working with these young stories and this director, writer. I mean, he wrote. He was prolific, and he had a thing for British music, especially for the Brits. So he had someone over there sending music, and it was just startling. We'd meet and we'd read through a piece of the script that's from Pretty in Pink,
mm-hmm.
and he said, "And here, I'm going to drop this in." And he drops in the song, and like, and you're sitting there and you're going, "Where the hell did he get that? That's great!"
Right?
No, well, none of us had it. It wasn't here yet.
Right. Yeah. So he was really trying to
kind of see that. Tears for Fears. The only hit they ever had was the one he asked them. You know, Simple Minds. I mean.
Which Simple Minds went to number one from Breakfast Club. Breakfast Club made $50 million in like 4 weeks.
Yes.
So it's like basically the movies were paired with music that also became. So it's interesting because visually, costume-wise, you're creating these looks that become like, you know, something that these kids can look up to. But then the movies not only become like the voice, their voice, it also became their soundtrack.
Yeah.
So it's like the soundtrack to their life mixed in within.
Yes.
So there's a really nice snapshot of life here. And I think that that's kind of the legacy that you guys have in this collaborations of all of these films together, which I find like as a body of work, it's just kind of unmatched in terms of like what that is. I also know that he's really famous for just like writing scripts quickly.
Yes.
Like, you know.
Yes.
One thing, and I don't see, like, I know you didn't do particularly those, but you have,
Uncle Buck was great.
Well, Uncle Buck was, and actually that's Macaulay Culkin's first film, correct?
Yeah.
So you have Uncle Buck, but you also, I think theoretically with John Hughes, he's kind of like the father of like, I think what we would consider like the holiday movie.
Oh.
Right? In terms of just like having those movies that kind of spawned off and being a part of like things like Uncle Buck, Home Alone.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
those types of things. So it's like, I think it's interesting when you talk about your collaborations with him in terms of how thought process he was and then how he really put the characters on the page and how it was your job to look at that and then somehow visually express it. And then have these things that like literally become films that people still watch today. I think that that kind of speaks to your talent and your craft as well. Because we do have films now, in some instances, not all, but we have films that kind of fly by night, right? It's like, it's a quick kind of like, this is quick. It's quick entertainment. But I often ask, especially costume designers that come from that kind of Hollywood magic time, which is, I love the 80s because they were just creative. Like, there was, you know, let's have this movie about this guy that's, you know, there are these kids that are in detention.
Yes.
Or let's have a movie about a mermaid or a kid that becomes big, or, like, you know, those things, you know, even a movie about a mannequin that came to life. Like, it's the 80s just was so full of fun like that.
Yeah.
And I think the Hughes movies really set that tone, where it was just being creative, coming up with, like, it was people. It was about people.
Real people.
About real people. And I like the creativity of that, and kind of how inspiring you guys were to just be like, okay, this is a moment. Mm-hmm. But I also like mentally how you were thinking about, it's a moment that I want to last.
Yes.
Because you can't really explain now. I can't explain how you can still watch these films today and they hold up. You know, and that you feel something from them.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like I wish sometimes film would get back to that, which was, it'd be like you leave a movie and it encompasses so much of how you feel, or that you need to watch it all the time. You need to watch it over and over and over and over again. And each time you watch it through, you feel that same thing.
It's true. And you know? They don't get old. It's unbelievable. It really is, because it's the only group of films that I've done that have that kind of soul and, you know, a consistency through the years. You can turn to it. It's still relevant.
How do you feel about it now? Like, now that it's passed and you saw what it became, like, how did you, like, when it started to become one of those things where you recognized it was like you were on to something, like, you know, like, because, like, these are doing really well. What did that feel like? And then how did it influence your work past that?
Well, it was a great feeling to accomplish, because I had already done two other young films
mm-hmm.
before I met John. And Fast Times mm-hmm. and I forgot the other one, with Sean Penn's brother, Chris Penn. May he rest in peace. Yeah. The Wildlife.
Wildlife.
Was the other one. Okay. So those films were so different than anything. This is its own everything. It really is. It stands alone. It doesn't go up against period films. It doesn't go up. It's psychological drama in a certain sense, with a reality check about growing up, you know, and what you have to look forward to, or what it is to be that age and to be, you know, suffering or happy, or, you know. So he was on the pulse of that more than anything. I don't think that, John Candy and he, I loved doing Uncle Buck, I have to say that. John Candy, I mm-hmm. loved. Because I had done him with Brewster's Millions with Richard Pryor.
Okay.
My other, God.
Just that both those names combined, just iconic people.
Yes. Brewster's Millions, Richard Pryor was something special. We'll talk about him another time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, God, love that man. So sweet. Anyway, but so the thing about doing these that I miss is I don't think any script I've gotten since, unless it's a psychological study of one person mm-hmm. or something, ever got to the places that these films reached. And that they live on. Because it's not just the look, it's the sound, it's what they're saying, it's how they're acting, it's, you know, and those situations are timeless.
Right. You know? Well, it's the key focus seems to be not just putting something out, but really paying attention to having something to say.
Yes.
I think that that's the key thing. And then it's in how you say it, what you're saying, how it's executed, how it's shown. Like, there's so many layers to these films, like you said, that are very psychological. And to break them down is to also realize how brilliant they are.
Yes.
You know, my favorite thing out of this interview is I did not know that. I love just the thought process that for you went into Ferris Bueller's Jacket, which I've seen that movie tons of times, but had no idea that that's what you were trying to do.
Well, I had to you had to figure out his character, and he wouldn't be any of those other things. You know, you have to work it for who the character is, and the clothing has meaning. Each thing has a certain kind of, it connotes a certain attitude or a certain period of time, you know. It's all about, this is all in the acting.
Yes.
This really is. I mean, in the writing, to read his screenplay is just amazing. That's how I was able to do boards. I came and I said, here, this is what I see. And they liked it right away. It was there. So I just gave it a vision, you know?
Well, there's got to be, we don't have much time left, but there is a quirky story that I want to bring out from you because I think it's fun, which is I remember you telling me some kind of story about meeting on a different set of another movie graveyard.
My husband, that's how I met all those producers. My husband was doing the music for the Warriors.
Okay.
And he was a musician in a singing group, and he did that as well. And so one night they were filming the Warriors in Coney Island at a cemetery. And the producers were there. And he brought me. That's where he brought me.
So okay? Those are the producers that then introduced you to John.
Yes.
Yes.
And to 15 other films.
So see, I had to bring this up just because it's one of those things. So Marilyn met the producers that introduced her to John and all these different films, and basically on the set of The Warriors in a cemetery.
That's right.
So I think when we talk about it, we always talk each week about just like even like what you're in or how do you do it. And I think the answer is it's everything. It could be anything. So I think just being determined to want to do your job, to do a good job, you know, and then being open to meeting people, I think is kind of a key.
Yeah. It's also you have to pay attention to life.
Yeah.
The real deal, you know, it's like, if you're doing a period film, you're going to go and get all this information. You're going to look everywhere to see whatever you can find. When you're doing these kind of films, more modern, that's why they live today.
Yeah.
Because we went into the underbelly of kids and what things can go down and how they would look and how you don't have to be trendy to still look like an athlete or to still, you know, look like... So that was the I learned a lot because I didn't want the film to be dated.
Yeah.
And because he was just such a great writer. Anything, it'll live on and on and on, the situations he puts his kids through, you know, and what he brings out. So I didn't want the clothing to take away from who they were. You know, I wanted it to be who they are.
So I think in terms of even just taking that balance and saying, okay, like you didn't want them to take away from who they are. Tell me really quickly what you mean by that in terms of like in really a character study.
It's like you watch a situation or a film and a person is dressed in such an outlandish way to you. You just don't see the connection of character. And the visual, it just doesn't match.
Right.
You know? And somehow I can't help myself with everything, including Die Hard when he loses his shirt and he's wearing an undershirt.
Mm-hmm.
It had to be a certain way. It just, you know, a vision.
A vision of it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And, you know, I'm an artist and I see through a lot of the things and I want to make it live on. I don't want to date anything. I don't want to be dated.
Yes.
Either.
Yeah. I want to thank you for this opportunity to talk to you about these iconic films and your work on them.
Thank you.
I also want to encourage people to come and listen to the podcast at www.designinghollywoodpodcast.com. That's a mouthful.
Yes.
Also, thank you to Rag Van Rentals, Eddie Marks. I also would like to give a little special shout out myself to my family. So hello, Jessica and Alina, Beanie Bean. And I also have to give a little special thank you to my friend, Nicholas Hibble, who is a huge John Hughes fan and helped me get me into the mind frame of this interview. He told me to tell you hello.
that's so lovely. Thank you.
He's from Chicago, the Midwest, so he's definitely a John Hughes all the way. And that was really it. So I just thank you so much. You can find me on Instagram at @Phil_Boutte.
Thank you.
Thank you to our sponsor, Eddie Marks with RagVan.com. RagVan is Hollywood's favorite place to rent fully equipped, high-quality trailers used by the entertainment industry to transport costumes and garments to and around filming sets in Hollywood. Also, thank you to our viewers. Be sure to follow Designing Hollywood Podcast on social media and subscribe to our podcast on iTunes, Spotify, Deezer, and our YouTube channel for complete past and current episodes.